insecticide has a very high impact on the ecology in terms they are highly reactive, they can affect the human health. They are highly reactive, they can interact with the soil microbiota, they can destroy the arthropods present in the soil, they can leach out in the water system. And so I can give you the one of the example, like they leach out in the water system and like this pesticide infected water goes in the river and then go to the sea. So like people have not studied yet in well detail, but this pesticide kills the algal blooms.
Okay.
And it is reducing the overall oxygen availability in marine environment and also the overall oxygen availability on the earth. And the marine ecosystem is also getting affected. So if you see like someone is spraying insecticide in some region of Vidarbha or Marathwada, it has impact in Arabian Sea or Pacific Ocean.
Hi everyone, welcome to Biotech Talks. Now today with us we have Dr. Rakesh Joshi with us, and we are going to discuss about his research. Now he is working on eco-friendly pesticides at NCL. Now why is he developing eco-friendly pesticides? What is the problem with pesticides which are currently available in the market? That is what we are going to discuss today. So you know what, I think everyone should know how global warming is affecting insect world and how that might affect our world, or it might be affecting it right now. So things like this and much more in this podcast. So I hope you enjoy it.
Hello sir, how are you?
I'm fine.
So your work here at NCL is to develop eco-friendly solution to deal with insects that are harming our agricultural crops. So which insects right now you are majorly focusing on?
So actually our lab is majorly focusing on cotton bollworm, which is Helicoarpa armigera, which is a specifically lepidopteran class of insect. First of all, actually we have to understand when we say something as a pest or insect, normal insect. When it started as an evolution, insects were like acting as pollinators.
Okay.
But as climate change, like earth get more and more warmer. So because due to the emission of CO2 or due to global warming as temperature, so some of the insects has increased their feeding behavior over particular crops that made them as a pest. So anything, any insect or any organism which is beyond certain level of their like population dynamics and can cause harm to the either crop productivity or any other, you can say the ecological resources, they called as a pest. So though insects serve as pollinators, but they are also herbivores, which called as a pest. So we majorly work on lepidopteran pests, which is of major concern across the world. They are a major class of insect pests causing the agriculture crop productivity loss. Till like if you talk about India, it causes almost 7,000 to 8,000 crore loss each year. Okay. And recent report from United Nations says that the total crop loss based on the severity of attack, it ranges from 30 to 40% of total productivity. So it's a major concern to deal with this lepidopteran pest.
Okay, so how global warming is affecting this insect world as you mentioned?
So as we know, like when we say a term global warming, it is dealing with the increasing in CO2 emission. So as carbon dioxide is increasing and temperature increasing, the metabolism get faster. So insect start to feed more and more on the crops, and at the same time they reproduce fast.
Okay.
So if anything is like reproducing very fast and feeding voraciously, that is something of major concern. So that converts insect to the pest. So the another like I will go in little detail. So in plant there is a immunity, and it is majorly regulated by two different pathway. One is so I won't go into the detail, but one pathway deals with the immunity against insect, and another immunity acts, or another pathway acts with the bacterial infection immunity. Due to the increase in carbon dioxide emission, the insect or immunity against the insect is reducing.
Okay.
because some molecular changes. So plants are more like insect don't have any barrier to like or any protection. Plant doesn't have any protection against this insect. So insects are increasing, like having more and more feeding on it. So there are multiple avenues of global warming. Like yesterday only there was article came in Nature Communication, which says that due to the increase in carbon dioxide and global warming, so there is a concept called as a insecticide resistance, like antibiotic resistance. Insects also get resistant to insecticides.
Okay.
So due to global warming, insects are getting 150-fold more resistant to the insecticides. So overall, it is like, I would say it is a multifaceted things, how global warming or how overall changes are affecting to the this insect status or pest status. One more thing, like as we know that glaciers are melting and the world is getting more and more warmer. So if you see the insects, they always stay on the, like they have more diversity on equatorial plane where the temperature is higher as compared to the, like if you talk about poles. So as this temperature is increasing, the there you can say a range, host range, and the area they are infecting, it is increasing because world is getting warmer. So they are spreading. I can give you an example of one of the insect called as a Plutella xylostella. So it is a small insect that is present in cabbages.
Okay.
In last 50 years, the total area that is infected due to this insect has been increased to almost 2.5 million kilometer square. So it is a huge area that it is covering now. So that's how like global warming, people are not just focusing toward that glaciers are melting or there is some changes, but global warming has a very, you can say the impact at a very ground level or basic level at the ecology also. So increase of insect attack is one example.
Okay, so as you mentioned that the resistance against insecticides is increasing, so what are other problems of this insecticides that are being currently used?
So like whatever the insecticide right now we are using, most of them are coming directly from lab to the land. So in a sense that like if you have one chemical and you are spraying it on insect, and if insect dies, you like launch them as an insecticide, like by looking at its MRL level and other regulatory things are there. But these things have now come into the picture, or people are having more regulatory, you can say, measures on pesticide. But initially when insecticide was developed, it was not that sophisticated process.
Okay.
Example, there are many insecticides which are of inhibitor of one of the enzyme, like take an example of acetylcholinesterase. But the same molecule can inhibit the human acetylcholinesterase, and same molecule can inhibit the any cattle acetylcholinesterase, bird acetylcholinesterase. So overall, it has an ecological off-targeting. So you have designed molecule against insect, but it is also affecting other organisms. So what is like, it has like, it is a very multifaceted thing. It has a different picture. Suppose you have an insect and you have spread the insecticide. Insect will develop the resistance, but cattle, predators, birds won't have that ability. So that's the reason we have insect explosion, but birds, sparrows, and other insects are dying.
Okay.
Or other like beneficial insects are dying because they don't have that, you can say, good machinery to come over the this insecticide. So insecticide has a very high impact on the ecology in terms they are highly reactive. They can affect the human health. They are highly reactive. They can interact with the soil microbiota. They can destroy the arthropods present in the soil. They can leach out in the water system. And so I can give you the one of the example, like they leach out in the water system, and like this pesticide infected water goes in the river and then go to the sea. So like people have not studied yet in well detail, but this pesticide kills the algal blooms.
Okay.
And it is reducing the overall oxygen availability in marine environment, and also the overall oxygen availability on the earth, and the marine ecosystem is also getting affected. So if you see like someone is spraying insecticide in some region of Vidarbha or Marathwada, it has impact in Arabian Sea or Pacific Ocean. So it is that. So that's the reason we are not looking at a big picture. It's a very, I would say, the burning issue, and it is really needs to be answered or worked with.
So how your work or research can be converted into a startup?
It is, I would say, a very far-sighted thing to convert anything. But what we are doing, I will explain that first. So what we are trying, so as I said, whatever molecule right now we have, they are directing toward the insect enzyme, which has homologs in other organisms also, or higher organisms. But we are looking for the targets or metabolism which are insect specific.
Okay.
So if you target this insect specific metabolism, the one thing that we can avoid, that it won't have ecological off targeting.
Yeah.
So we are not saying that we will completely abolish the ecological off targeting, but we can minimize it.
Okay.
So we are trying to work on the neglected insect metabolisms which are invertebrate specific, and if we can target them. And the second part that we are working with, that whatever the chemical pesticides right now we have in the market, they are synthetic pesticides and highly reactive, so they can easily react with the proteins, DNA, or anything. But we are looking for a natural molecules which are already present in the environment. You have to just use them at perfect place.
Okay.
So they can act as a, so like we have a big revolution of Bt toxin. It's a natural molecule.
Okay.
And it is highly effective. So in 1999, there was paper came in PNS, which has coined this term called as a dietary pesticides. So you have a molecules in diet, or whatever you can say, the nutritious molecule for us or for the environment, that can be toxic to the insect. So we are exploring these dietary pesticides, which we can eat, but insect will die.
Yeah. So till now we discussed how these insects are harmful to us and how we can overcome them. But is there any way to harness insects in a biotechnological way for our betterment?
Yeah. So I would say this is very interesting thing. We know that if we talk about bioprospecting, people are just looking toward the microbial diversity. But there was paper came in a Science 3-4 years back. It has reported 2 million insect species and their diversity. And they have said that understanding this 2 million insect species diversity, just tapping on the surface of the insect diversity. So insect biomass contributes to the 42% of total biomass of Earth. And the diversity, so once the former president of Royal Society, Martin Rees, said that insects, understanding insects is far more challenging than understanding the stars.
Okay.
And so insect diversity is such a huge, and it has such a beautiful, I would say, gene batteries that can perform different chemical reactions which are impossible naturally. So you use this catalyst, or you use this enzyme as a biocatalyst, and you can use them to convert some, you can say, a precursor molecule to the value-added products.
Okay.
Similarly, there are many applications, in Europe, there are many places where you have delicacies made from an insect. So insect can serve as a very good alternative to, as a food source for the meat or red meat or white meat.
Yeah, I once watched in Discovery that insects are rich source of protein and people are eating them.
Yeah.
They are having that habit now.
Yeah. So it's also habit, but it's now need.
Yeah.
Actually, whatever the, again, it will come to the global warming, whatever the global warming we are creating from the red and white meat industry, it's far more alarming than whatever we are considering. So if we have this kind of alternative as a food source, it could be very beneficial, because they are more nutritious than whatever that this meat options can provide. The another application of insects that some people are exploring, that insect can eat the plastics and they can degrade the plastics.
Okay.
So there is an enzyme called as a petase, which is present in many insects. That petase came from the pet bottle or pet ether. which is a polymer of plastic. So it is a very good way of bioremediation or biodegradation. Also, there are many proteins or therapeutic products that can be isolated from the insects. But as I said, right now people are just tapping the microbial diversity for bioprospecting. Insect diversity is far more huge than the microbial diversity, and we haven't started yet.
So what is the need to do research on insects, especially in case of India?
So I would say if I will talk about broad in terms of agriculture or agriculture allied areas, if we look at the country need in terms of food security or food availability in India or other things like changing in the monsoon pattern or changing in the crop rotation, there are so many trivial issues related with, I would say, just agriculture. It's okay that if we are going toward the areas which are far more rewarding and far more appealing in terms of, you can say, the grants or getting acceptance at paper, or you can say impact factor or getting recognition. But when it comes to the country need, need of India, when our Prime Minister say Atmanirbhar Bharat, Atmanirbhar Bharat won't be happen if our 80% of the chemical needed for agriculture are coming from China.
Okay.
It won't happen if we are just outsourcing a research for agriculture from Western countries. Our need, our challenges for agriculture or other issue, you talk about having hygiene or clean water for drinking or having healthcare for everything. These are the need of country like India. And I think researcher like me and researcher which are going to come into the next generations, they should also do the cutting edge research to compete with the other world. But we have to be more focused or more taken more challenges on the questions that are relevant for India. So I think when we say, I said this 2-3 times, so when we say a Sujalam Sufalam Bharat, it won't happen if we don't work toward that.
Yeah.
And even if I talk about agriculture, M.S. Swaminathan did Green Revolution in 1960s and 1970. Now it's 50 years.
Okay.
And when our 60% population is on agriculture, we cannot rely on the Green Revolution that has happened decades or few decades ago. We need Green Revolution in each and every year and each and every month. That's how India will be a Sujalam Sufalam.
Okay. So that was interesting to know. Thank you for your time.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.